Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Rocky Boyer's War, an unvarnished history of the air blitz that won the war in the Southwest Pacific, by Alan D. Boyer. Narrated by Joe Barrett. Author's Note: This book follows and draws on a diary kept by Lieutenant Roscoe A. Boyer, my father, during his service in the Southwest Pacific. This diary is currently in my possession. The book reflects my father's own experiences and readings of events, his opinions and recollections. To frame or expand on what he wrote, I have used other material, primary sources where possible, unit histories, missing aircrew reports, service newspapers, stateside newspapers, and commander's memoirs. Sometimes I have verified what he reported, other times clarified or corrected it. But my father speaks in his own voice. His assessment of events he witnessed and people he encountered is unflinching, and at times unflattering, and his observations are presented as he recorded them during his time in the Pacific. Spelling and usage have been modernized and standardized. My father wrote grammatically and spelled well, but he constantly used abbreviations, frequently printed whole entries in block capitals, never indented a line or broke for a paragraph, and sometimes wrote as carelessly as some people type. Writing 70 years ago, in the middle of a war, my father wrote of the enemy as nips or japs, offensive slurs. This was the language of the military in which he served. It has not been changed. He himself did not use those terms with mockery or contempt. He considered that the Japanese fought with courage and intelligence, and if he armed warplanes that flew against them, there were times when he thought he might die at their hands. The only people to whom my father ever applied a disrespectful epithet were West Point graduates. Ring knockers, he called them, after their customary way of calling a meeting to order. Introduction: A War and a Diary. Half an hour before midnight, the first Japanese shell exploded overhead. It was a star shell, a sudden smear of blinding white light against the black night sky, and the scorching glare lit up the airfield. The bomb craters in the runway, the tanks of aviation gas drained dry, the gray smoke above the fire in the bomb dump, the control tower and the banked-up bomber and the burning wreck of the fighter plane, the brass shell casing fired off by the anti-aircraft guns, and on the tarmac a scattering of silhouettes and shadows, the handful of 5th Air Force men and the empty bomb trolleys they were wheeling back into cover. They were the airmen of the 71st Tactical Reconnaissance Group. Reconnaissance meant that they flew patrols looking for the Japanese. Tactical meant that if they found the Japanese, they bombed and strafed them. This evening, things were spun around. The Japanese had moved first and gotten too close. For once, the airmen knew exactly where the Japanese were. What they did not know was whether they could stop the Japanese warships before the Japanese found the range and brought their guns to bear on the airfield. All that evening, in the dark, they had worked to arm the planes. They had sent out every bomber and fighter bomber that could fly, carrying every bomb they could find and find fuses for. Not all of their planes had come back, and some that did had been shot full of holes. None of that had made a difference. For 3 long hours now, they had watched the Japanese warships come south along the coast toward them. They had seen searchlights and ripples of flame and sometimes a swarm of firefly lights in the darkness. The firefly lights were their own bombers' running lights, and the ripples of flame were enemy anti-aircraft guns shooting at the bombers. No matter what their planes had done, the Japanese ships were still coming south. They were in the Philippines, on the island of Mindoro. It was 1944, a hot, dry evening, the day after Christmas. Since the year began, they had fought their way north, from New Guinea to the Philippines, 2,000 miles of mountains, jungle, islands, and oceans. In the 5th Air Force, they had been the artillery for Douglas MacArthur's army, and sometimes the tank corps, too. The airfields had been the front line. They had made rough landings in valleys where airfields could be built, flown in squadrons of airplanes while the Japanese were still being cleared out, and moved the front line forward. They had sidestepped entire Japanese armies and cut them off and left them behind, sitting on empty islands. They thought MacArthur was an ass, but he hadn't made many mistakes, and he hadn't gotten them slaughtered on beachheads. Mindoro was close to the Japanese and far from help. This time MacArthur might have made a mistake. They were 300 miles from the 6th Army Divisions on Leyte, farther still from any friendly airbase, nowhere near any Navy fleet. They would have to handle by themselves whatever the Japanese threw at them. At their last base, Japanese paratroopers had landed on the runway shouting Banzai and firing submachine guns. That recollection was on everyone's mind. Tonight, the radio section was talking about a convoy of enemy troop ships. One bomber pilot had seen landing barges alongside the destroyers. Against paratroopers with submachine guns, all they had would be their pistols. And against the Japanese cruisers, their bombers didn't seem to have done much good. If the Japanese warships were firing star shells now, they would be firing high-explosive shells next. That night on Mindoro, Rocky Boyer, First Lieutenant Roscoe A. Boyer, was one of the officers loading the bombs. He was my father. Rocky was 25 then. In his young life, he had been a farm boy, a college boy, a draftee, and a sergeant, and now he was communications officer for the 110th Tactical Reconnaissance Squadron. The next day, out of the officers in his tent, he would be the only man left alive. In the Southwest Pacific during the war, no one was supposed to keep a diary. At reunions after the war, when they found out that Rocky had done that, other men from his old squadron looked again at him, sharply. They knew that Rocky had kept their radios working. They had heard that he had been a college professor after the war and retired as a full colonel. They had to think about what he might have said. They had been on troop ships with Rocky and flown over the same mountains that he had. They knew the same places, Moresby and Nadzab and Biak, and where servicemen went on leave in Sydney. They had stood around in the same blacked-out tropical midnights, waiting for the sirens or gunshots that would sound the all clear. They had had the same friends whose planes hadn't come back. They had shot the breeze together and listened to Radio Tokyo and griped about Colonel Hutchison and rejoiced when retribution overtook Colonel Brownfield. They had gone to church with him, and Rocky might know what had happened that time when the chaplain wrote to MacArthur. Rocky had stolen a jeep for them. He was the officer they sent to buy beer because he was the officer who didn't drink. That night at Mindoro, when the Japanese ships shelled them, Rocky had driven to the airfield in the blackout and helped Smitty and Jensen load up the P-40s. Rocky kept his diary during a year that took him from a Mississippi training base to New Guinea and from New Guinea to the Philippines, the Southwest Pacific Air War of 1944. Of that brilliant and hard-fought campaign, an American blitzkrieg led by planes instead of tanks, Rocky told a narrative in counterpoint. He tried out titles, The Prelude to Battle, or Behind the Lines, but his tone was never grandiloquent. Once he remarked that he had been a lieutenant when he kept the diary, and that he had probably thought that anyone with a higher rank was a scoundrel. He agreed with what Bill Malden said, that every soldier wanted to write a book exposing the army after the war. The story is wrapped around three battles and a scandal, but it is not the Pacific War of the standard histories. The pilots Rocky knew did not dogfight with Zeros. They shot it out with Japanese anti-aircraft gunners. They strafed Japanese aircraft and freighters and had their own warplanes burned to cinders. They died in bad weather and when their engines cut out on them and when they buzzed the airstrip. They had staff officers who got drunk and cut loose with pistols. They heard rumors and read newspapers, and they played office politics in the base HQ. They wanted to be promoted, and they wanted to go home. This is their story of the air war. 1. From Sugar Creek to Salinas. The story was front-page news. Roosevelt's peacetime draft had taken hold of its first Franklin College graduate. On commencement afternoon, the Franklin Evening Star announced, "It'll be a short jump from campus life to army life for Roscoe Boyer of Frankfort, Franklin College graduate and athlete." Boyer graduates at 4 o'clock this afternoon and is scheduled to report to his draft board in Frankfurt at 8 o'clock Tuesday morning for induction into the U.S. Army for a year of training. A veteran football player, Boyer saw action on the Grizzly squad for 3 years. He had planned to enter the teaching profession upon graduation. His field is mathematics, and he had taught a semester at Masonic Home High School as a practice instructor. Boyer has accepted his fate in good humor and plans to continue his hobby of sketching and drawing while in the Army. In fact, Rocky felt no good humor. The draft and the Army hung over his life for long years. The Army would ship him back and forth across the continent. The 5th Air Force would send him halfway around the world. It would be 5 years before he taught high school math again. It would be 6 years before he married the girl who watched him walk across the stage for his diploma. Rocky Boyer was born in March 1919 in Sugar Creek Township, Clinton County, 40 miles north of Indianapolis. The road to the city ran past Vonnegut's Hardware. Clinton County was farmland then, and it is farmland now. Huge square fields of corn and soybeans, and hogs looking back at you through the fence. The Boyer family had raised corn and taught school there since the land was cleared. Rocky's father was Van Roscoe Boyer. Rocky's mother was Laura Hester Wright, from Washington, Indiana. Her father was a truck farmer, a stocky little man who grew vegetables for the markets in St. Louis and Chicago, and worked hard enough to send to college his daughter as well as his son. Laura was a petite auburn-haired girl, pretty, who painted and made jewelry. Van was tall and broad-shouldered, with a pointed sense of humor. He had turned down a newspaper job to stay on and run the farm. It was not easy. Van got his crops in each year and taught high school history and Sunday school. Laura painted with watercolors, which were cheaper than oils, and joined ladies' societies. They handled what farming threw at them, but the effort left them angry. They could be tense and bitter. Van was a Democrat in a Republican county and blamed the politicians because the road past his house was gravel, not asphalt. Laura had illnesses that she did not talk about. Rocky played high school basketball. Outside school, he raised show calves, bringing home ribbons from as far afield as Cleveland. Hybrid corn was being introduced, and the seed companies offered money for prize seed corn. Rocky spent long afternoons in the corn crib, choosing the 10 most perfect ears of Reed's Yellow Dent field corn. For that, he won a prize as well. Rocky went to Franklin College. He majored in mathematics and helped start the science club. He lived in the Sigma Alpha Epsilon house and paid his way through school by doing chores in the SAE kitchen. He played guard for the Franklin Grizzlies football team. Rocky was strong. To water the livestock, he had worked a pump handle hundreds of times a night, every night, for years. But he did not have the massive frame of a lineman. In the fall of 1940, when she was a Franklin College freshman, Margaret Ann Dillard first heard Rocky's name when the cheerleaders called for a cheer when he was being carried off the field. Margaret Ann was from southern Indiana's Orange County, from the county seat of Paoli, with its sawmills and limestone quarries, not the spa towns of French Lick and West Baden. She was a bright, pretty young woman with long, dark hair and expressive eyes. She was an English major, an officer of Pi Beta Phi, an editor-in-chief of the Franklin Student Newspaper. The first movie they went to had a quick gag about a dog and a fire hydrant. He laughed at it and then apologized. They walked back to campus along the middle of the street, something she had never done before. She liked the way he laughed and the way he walked. They went out again often, to the nook on campus, where you could buy 5-cent ice cream cones. Rocky's senior year at Franklin began in September 1940. That same month, Congress passed the Selective Service Act. It soon was clear that Rocky would be called up. The draft board allowed him 6 months deferment, enough to finish college. On June 10, 1941, the day he was inducted, Rocky began keeping a journal. "My first day out in this cold, cruel world," he began. "Yes, the draft got me, and how. The crowd that gathered at the armory was perhaps one of the most cheerless masses that I have ever witnessed. All the mothers, fathers, in-laws, sweethearts were there. My mother never let go a tear. She is too much of a lady, thank God. On the bus down, there were 24 of us. No comments were made at first, except that we were on a one-way bus, and the cynical expressions upon the boys' faces were obvious. The undertaking seemed to be taken as a challenge. Most of the men were chain smokers, but perhaps that tension will work off. At least I hope so. This evening, I wrote my parents and Margaret Ann a card. Never before in my life have I desired to see a girl, any girl, one that would maybe turn and speak. Margaret Ann, she's swell, and if I could only see her or maybe talk, well, it's best that I should forget her anyway. In his postcard to Margaret Ann, Rocky objected, I am in the army now, although I cannot recognize my mother across the street. Rocky had bad eyes without his glasses, but the army and his draft board did not care about that. By the weekend, Rocky was on a train to Camp Walters, Texas, west of Dallas. Rocky wrote that he had peeled potatoes across the state of Missouri. At Camp Walters, the food improved, and the company was more congenial. The fellows in my battalion can do something besides talk about getting drunk, dice, cards, and lewd women. These fellows write in all their spare time and buy newspapers galore. When the fellows do talk, it is about some current events or some paramount problems. The secondary schools of Indiana are well represented by fellows from Wabash, DePaul, Ball State, Goshen, Franklin, Purdue is here, while IU is not here. Also, Indiana Central is forgotten. Among the recruits, Rocky met Jews for the first time and liked them. Before, he had seen Jews only from a distance, in the stockyards, shochtim, slaughtering steers in accordance with kosher law. Little rabbis, farmers called them, quizzically but respectfully. A Jewish draftee taught Rocky how to play chess, a favor he never forgot. Over the summer, it became clear that draftees would see much more of the war than a year of training. On this point, Rocky had sour conjectures. As usual, England will have someone else fight their war, and as usual, Franklin D. Roosevelt is looking after a few already rich men's interest in Europe and will send our youths over to Europe. 75% of the fellows here will attempt to run away if the present bill passes. Nearly all of these letters are written during a 10-minute break, which we get every hour. During these intervals, the men usually relax on their cots and curse Roosevelt, which I hope that another Boyer never votes for again. He broke his word once, and he'll do it again. This was unexpected. Rocky had been a staunch Democrat. His only lapse had been to attend Wendell Willkie's huge hometown rally at Elwood, Indiana, holding his younger sister, Andora, on his shoulders. Van read Rocky's letters and said something about his son deserting and going off to join the Russians. But Rocky's tone was shifting. His morale was better. Our company is permanently organized. Our latest plans are to contact a few sororities at Texas Christian and exchange, well, anything. We have several fraternity men within our group. We have sent form letters to 3 different sororities. We plan to exchange several social affairs since we have Saturday afternoon and Sunday off. 4 years of being an SAE had left their mark. However downtrodden, Rocky was ready to plan a set of fraternity mixers. But he made fewer self-pitying perorations. He began making sententious pronouncements. Increasingly, he was humorous. Last night I went to see a moving picture, Penny Serenade, in which an earthquake lasted for more than a minute. However, in history there have been only 2 quakes that lasted more than a minute. One in 1923, I think, in Japan, and the other when a South Sea island blew up. This morning, the Articles of War were read to us, all 110 of them. The Army shuttled Rocky to Fort Custer in Michigan, back to Fort Leonard Wood, then to Fort Carson in Colorado. Whenever the barracks failed inspection, the men ran the belt line, a gauntlet between 2 long lines of fellow soldiers, every man whipping at each runner with the sharp buckle of a GI belt. Rocky got tired of running the belt line because the latrine had failed inspection. He spent an evening cleaning the toilets and the sinks. The sergeant noticed the difference and asked who had done it, and Rocky was promoted to private first class. Soon he made sergeant. One night, the first sergeant in his outfit got drunk and wrecked a jeep. He was busted, and Rocky moved up. He had his own clerk and driver now. The division was shipping out when an application that Rocky had filed earlier was accepted. He became an Air Corps cadet at Scottfield in Illinois, which boasted that it produced the best damned radio operators in the world. In November 1942, Rocky was mustered out as a sergeant and commissioned as a second lieutenant. He was assigned to Salinas, outside San Francisco, where the 71st Observation Group, as it was known at the time, was flying anti-submarine patrols. He came home to Indiana once, in May 1943, when the group moved east to Louisiana. He saw Margaret Ann at Franklin and gave her his SAE pin. Later that month, the 71st Group's headquarters moved from Shreveport to Laurel, Mississippi. Rocky was in charge of the convoy. From his mobile headquarters, he sent Margaret Ann a letter. "Where am I? In the back end of a bouncing radio truck, and we just passed Camp Shelby, Mississippi. These little silent coronas come in handy in such conditions as this, for it enables one to write no matter how rough the road might be. By the way, I have on a pair of earphones and am listening to music. This is fun, writing you, seeing the country. All I need is an ice cream cone and a blue-eyed girl on my right. One on my left always cramps my style, if I had one. What shall we talk about, college profs or radio or you? Time out for popcorn. We got it at Ellisville. And finally, I can return the favor. Here are two grains for you. Almost time to stop and attempt to contact the 17th Squadron radio station, which is standing by for us at Laurel. See you later this afternoon, darling. Rocky." Margaret Ann kept the letter and envelope, with the jokes and the fondness, and two flattened-out kernels of popcorn. 2. Shipping Out. At Laurel Army Airfield in September 1943, security was tightening. Gates were being locked now, guards posted, unit insignia being snipped off uniforms. At night in the barracks, first sergeants were making random bed checks. Colonel William Sams, commanding officer of the 71st Tactical Reconnaissance Group, had started the lectures in July. "Do not discuss your planes," he had warned his airmen. "Do not discuss supplies, inspections, or morale. In particular, do not disclose any changes of station. If you receive personal visits, letters, telegrams, or phone calls at the new destination, this fact will be considered prima facie evidence that you have told someone the destination, and you will be court-martialed. But being sentenced won't keep you from going overseas unless you are shot. It might cost you your life from drowning. Your family or friends must not come to see you." The group's move overseas had begun 6 months before, in a conversation no one in the group had shared. Across a desk in Washington, a general had asked his president for aircraft. Face to face with Franklin Delano Roosevelt was George Kenney, commander of the 5th Air Force, senior airman in the Southwest Pacific, where he was running the air war for Douglas MacArthur. Kenney was a short, energetic man, a scrappy terrier of a general. Never at a loss for words, always ready with figures and arguments, he was a debater born wrong, or perhaps a world-class public relations man. He knew he was fighting the Japanese on a shoestring, while bombers and troops poured into Europe. Kenney had a story to tell his president, the story of the Battle of the Bismarck Sea, how his pilots had strafed, bombed, and sunk all 14 ships and a convoy of Japanese troop ships. Roosevelt asked if Kenney were getting more warplanes. Kenney said no. Then Kenney made a joke to make a pitch. The president had made so many other commitments that there were no planes left for his 5th Air Force. The president laughed and said he guessed he'd have to look into the matter, Kenney wrote. "I got a hunch that I was going to get some airplanes." Kenny's hunch was right. Before he left Washington, the Joint Chiefs of Staff promised him airplanes. They did not offer him the planes he wanted, B-24 Liberators and P-38 Lightnings. The Army was buying B-17 Flying Fortresses and P-51 Mustangs, because that was what the 8th Air Force in England wanted. The Joint Chiefs promised Kenney 3 groups of bombers and 2 groups of fighters, provided that he would take planes that no other theater wanted and find crews for them among the men he already had. Then, for a bonus, the Joint Chiefs offered Kenney 1 further unit, 4 squadrons worth of aircraft packaged together in an observation group. No war is fought like clockwork, but the president's words had something of that effect. They set men in motion across the continent, gradually but inexorably. The 71st Observation Group became the 71st Tactical Reconnaissance Group. The group headed east, from Louisiana to Mississippi, from Esler Army Airfield to Laurel Army Airfield, flight crews in their bombers, mechanics in jeeps, and a young lieutenant in a bouncing radio truck, listening to the radio and typing a love letter. In September, Rocky opened a new notebook. He was 24 now. He had been in the service for 3 long summers. He had shed his draftee's self-pity, mostly, but he still indulged a sense of melodrama. "Finder," he printed. "This is the diary of Lieutenant Boyer, Roscoe A, 0-856663, AC, Rural Route 3, Frankfort, Indiana, USA. Then he skipped a line and wrote out a title in block capitals, "The Prelude to Battle." He dated it in careful block letters, September 8, 1943. "We'll sail from San Francisco. The combat crew members will leave from Hamilton Field. We'll carry both winter and summer uniforms. That means we're going to India or China, for they told me troops going to the islands are taking only suntans. Also, we're not taking any heavy tents, and that's a good sign. They thought we would receive our orders to move around October 3rd. And for God's sake, Boyer, don't tell a damn person." Thus spoke Lieutenant Melvin Beck during our very confidential conversation in our radio truck following his plane trip to Barksdale Field, Shreveport, Louisiana. Rocky was not the only officer to begin a diary. Another airman in the group would ask a year later, as a joke and reminiscence, "How many guys started diaries that never finished them?" The colonel would be keeping a diary, so too a flight surgeon, and a clutch of eager young men with lieutenant's bars and pilot's wings, and a mechanic of steady industry and few words. No diarist seemed to have parsed the Army regulation that diaries be collected periodically and stored in rear areas, nor the recent Field Artillery Journal article that urged that soldiers might keep diaries restricted to individual routine life. There was as yet no sign that anyone in the 71st Group might write what Bill Mauldin said every soldier wanted to write, a book exposing the Army after the war. There were double guards at the base gates, and the Mississippi Highway Patrol had been alerted to watch the roads outside. Mail was now posted in each squadron's orderly room, where officers could keep an eye on it, not through the base post office. No civilians were to be admitted to the base except those employed there. The days, however, were hot as well as long, and morale demanded that certain exceptions be made. An officer from each building where there is a Coca-Cola dispensing unit should contact Lieutenant Thanham at the post exchange relative to the servicing of the unit. Before calisthenics, Major Smith, our intelligence officer, and I discussed the personal items we should take overseas. Can openers, a year's supply of soap, the kind that will float, who knows, we may be washing in rivers, handkerchiefs, razor blades, preference of shaving soap over shaving cream because the latter may be broken and damage other articles, books, a few we are carrying are the Decameron of Boccaccio, the Bible, Leaves of Grass, collection of short stories, poetry, dictionary, and a few contemporary plays, sport shoes, swimming trunks, toilet paper, perhaps a few rubbers to be used not only for the prevention of disease, but also to cover flashlights, batteries, etc., toothbrushes, heavy paper for the sleeping bag, diary, sewing kit, ink, camera film, and a large knife. Of course, we'll think of many other things as time goes by. The week ahead would be spent hiking, 5 miles Monday, 7.5 miles Tuesday, 10 miles Wednesday, 12 miles Thursday, and 15 miles on Friday. all followed by regular parade on Saturday. The hikes were facts, but there was a metaphor behind them. The men of the 71st Group now could see that they were headed overseas. At our first 5-mile hike, 50% of the men developed blisters. Their discipline was poor. Some smoked in ranks, waved their arms, commented about passing civilians. Much to everyone's surprise, the colonel went along. Major William Tennille of the 17th Bomb Squadron paced his men over the 5-mile route without a break in 1 hour and 10 minutes. The major has been wearing house slippers ever since. Next day, the pace was slower. The cadence dropped from 120 beats per minute to 110 beats, falling away from the official Army quick step. The sore-footed airmen saw other signs that reason was creeping into the process. At our 7.5-mile hike today, the colonel went again, and after the march took his staff car to check the mileage. Undoubtedly, he thought, as did the rest of us, that it was nearer 9 miles than 7. Rumored the colonel called off the hikes for Wednesday. If the men were surprised to see Colonel Sam's hiking with them, they did not yet know him well. A commanding officer ex officio is called the old man. Sam seemed even older to some of his flyers. He was 37 years old, people said he had medical conditions, and he was a career man from the spit-and-polish regular Army. When anyone asked about promotions, Sam's pointed out the long years he himself had spent as a lieutenant. Sam's had a wife and children, and he husbanded his men and planes. But Sam's was also the sort of officer whose energy and elan American soldiers describe by borrowing foreign terms. In the Lafayette Escadrille, they would have called him un beau sabour. In more recent years, they would have labeled him gung-ho. Sam's had waited 17 years to fly warplanes in combat and was not going to miss his chance. As for Major Tennille, there was something to take seriously in the rumor Rocky heard. Bill Tennille was wearing slippers because his feet were blistered. With his fast-paced, forced march, Tennille had shown that he had a passion for speed, that he would share without flinching his men's tasks and pains, and that he was eager to drive too hard. He was the sort of officer, all this suggested, who would order a charge and then rush in at its head. The 82nd Squadron, which flew fighter planes, was taking orders from a different species of commander, Major Donald M. Gordon. Months before, at DeRidder Army Airfield in Louisiana, Gordon had begun to earn his men's contempt. He had chewed them out for blowing out tires when they landed their P-39s and told them he would show them how it was done. He took up his own plane and landed flawlessly. Then, while taxiing, he carelessly flipped the wrong switch and, instead of retracting his flaps, folded up his airplane's wheels. It was a common mistake, but it was a fool mistake, and Gordon picked this moment to make it. The whole squadron watched and heard the screeching, propeller-bending crash. They sent a jeep out to pick up Gordon. The flyers then sat by in a group, no man among them saying a word, while the major walked through them back to his quarters. By September 24th, the 71st Group was packed for wherever they were bound. Rocky had tried to add to the assortment of items he was taking overseas. I tried to get a girl to get a bottle of ink in town for me, but not my luck. Must be losing my grip, he wrote. They had been packing in the rain, and a master sergeant said they would have enough water to last a month whenever they opened the waterproof boxes. The 110th Squadron was being split off. Someone said General George Kenney had seen them on maneuvers and didn't want them in his Air Force. Everyone had spent 2 days loading railroad flat cars and waiting for a switch engine, and that night the tension broke. Last night, 80% of the officers were drunk. The evening started with gambling, poker, rummy, blackjack, and craps, and ended with a football game in the officers' club. Most of the glasses were broken, and no fights resulted, but about 2 this morning, we were awakened by 3 officers driving a jeep across the boardwalks between trees and through the small ditches. Left Laurel at 4:30 p.m. The train consisted of 10 coaches, 2 boxcars serving as baggage, and 1 baggage car converted into a GI kitchen. Personnel included HQ, an 82nd Fighter Squadron. The 17th Bomb Squadron was supposed to follow us immediately. The train turned east at the gate, so it looks like the East Coast. The newspaper headlines say, 12 ships sunk. By breakfast time, they reached Atlanta. On the third day, they reached Camp Patrick Henry, outside Newport News. Here, Rocky first heard, officially, where they were headed. Some island north of Australia. The officers of the 71st Group had spent 2 years preparing for combat. They had seen the end of the beginning of the war. They had watched the Japanese overrun the Pacific and then be stopped by the United States Navy at Midway, by the Marines on Guadalcanal, and by Douglas MacArthur in New Guinea. What lay ahead could be read in the headlines of the newspapers they bought on their way eastward, for not every story was about ships being sunk. That week, the banner headlines thundered about Italy and Corsica and Mark Clark's Fifth Army and Nazis burning the city of Naples. Doughty British flyers had put Germany under an aerial siege. Europe came first and would continue to come first. News from other theaters made the front page, too, but in shorter stories and smaller type. The Allies had taken Finchhofen and raided Rabaul. MacArthur might have a rival supremo in Mountbatten. News stories about Mountbatten may have been why the group heard so many rumors about going to China. And from the Southwest Pacific, a wire story reported an advance by airmen and infantry. Australians, landed by big American transport planes, have seized Kayapit, 60 miles north of newly captured Lae, New Guinea. The transports swept down on a grassy field last Saturday night and Sunday, disgorging Australians who repulsed enemy counterattacks and drove the Japanese out of the immediate area. At Camp Patrick Henry, waiting to sail, they spent 8 days. Officers were housed in the post bachelor officer quarters. The post had a chapel, paneled in dark wood, with chimes donated by the Firestone family. Rocky went to 3 services there. So did other servicemen. The chapel was so small, or so popular, that every seat in its pews was taken. Other officers found different ways to pass time. The senior officers went out on Saturday night, the colonel, the intelligence officer, and the flight surgeon together. It did not end well. They returned to the BOQ at 0415 and woke most everyone, Rocky recorded. Major Smith had a cut on his head, and blood was quite noticeable on the boardwalk in front of the BOQ. On October 5th, finally, they boarded the USS General John S. Pope. The Pope was a new Army troop ship, fast enough to sail without a convoy. Rocky's stateroom was crowded with officers. One was Chaplain Smith, Lieutenant Frederick C. Smith, a Southern Baptist preacher. Rocky was used to talking with preachers and wrote down what the chaplain confided, that the senior officers should stop chasing nurses, that some men due to ship out had suddenly declared to him that they were homosexuals, and that only 2 Jews were left in the group. Smith was the oldest man in the stateroom, probably the tallest, trained at the Southern Baptist Seminary in Louisville and the Army Chaplain School at Harvard. Rocky thought that Chaplain Smith was changing during the trip. Often wonder why he tells some of those shady stories. Is it his true nature, or is he trying to impress us with his sophistication, or doesn't he know any better, or is he attempting to become one of us? The other officers in the stateroom were all young lieutenants. Rocky offered a set of sketch portraits. Lieutenant Gilbert, West Pointer, impressed me by his deep friendliness. Lieutenant Dixon is another West Pointer, quiet, complacent, affable. Lieutenant Alexander is never wrong and is all for Alexander and thus a true Californian. Lieutenant Foster knows but never tries to impress. Lieutenant Mosher of the 17th Squadron is strictly a student of books. Lieutenant Foss attempts to be a brain on all subjects. Lieutenant Tate is quiet, a Texan, and a very fine man. Lieutenant Parks of Marion, Indiana, perhaps has more brains, master of many sciences, knows hundreds of cowboy songs, and is unconscious of his entertainment. Lieutenant Wilkie, a typical Missouri mule, very practical, brains galore, has been a man about the world and will have the last word in any argument. Hates the Army. Willard Gilbert and Lyndall Tate would retire as colonels, as would Rocky Boyer. Charles Foss and Donald Alexander would transfer out. Chaplain Smith would expose a scandal that it took two generals to bury. Bob Foster was weather officer and wore a harried look. Ralph Wilkie was a handsome young man with upswept coal-black hair, a rockabilly guitarist before the term was coined. George Butch Dixon looked self-confident, even smug, which perhaps explains what happened later. Of Lawrence Lundberg, Rocky said nothing, but Lundberg would earn the Distinguished Flying Cross twice, on two afternoons 12 years apart, giving his life the second time. Hugh Mosher would be dead before summer. Officers were crowded into staterooms, but enlisted men were packed into compartments down below the waterline. 400 men in an area 80 feet long, 65 feet wide, less than 9 feet high, jammed with tiers of bunks. Officers had mattresses and sheets. Enlisted men slept on canvas. Officers were assigned compartment duty, watching over enlisted men. Some officers talked about wearing pistols when they went below. The trip was not comfortable, but it was not eventful. Most of the activity aboard ship can be classified under racking up time, sleeping, gambling, reading, sitting, and being sick. There's a regulation stating that no drinking will take place aboard ship, and there has been none. As for gambling, yesterday it was reported that one officer won $475. 2 or 3 days ago, one enlisted man said a Marine had won $4,000 in a craps game in the latrine. Colonel Sam sat on the boxing tournament steering committee with four chaplains and two Navy doctors. Chaplains on troop ships were advised to bring 6 pairs of boxing gloves, 2 punching bags, and 2 medicine balls. The tournament filled out the pages of the Crow's Nest, the ship's journal, in an issue that featured advice on Australia, a plea to return books to the ship's library, and him sing Big Success. Rocky and the other lieutenants talked about the female situation in our unknown theater. They all agreed the American soldiers would not rape women as the Japs. However, there will be isolated instances. And the reason? The U.S. soldier prides himself in his ability in means of seduction. They also agreed, except the chaplain, those black women will become whiter every day. In 4 days, they reached the Panama Canal. 2 days after leaving the canal, they crossed the equator. 6 days later, in the South Pacific, they neared the line on the map that marked the eastern border of the war zone. Before noon, it was reported throughout the ship that a naval radio operator was listening to a Tokyo news broadcast and heard that our ship, by its actual name, USS General John Pope, was sunk just outside the Panama Canal 6 days ago. Could it be that we are dead already? Panama was now 4,000 miles behind them. Australia was more than 4,000 miles ahead. In that blank quadrant of ocean, Rocky recorded a dream. Woke and felt very tired, for during the night I dreamt I met Norman Vandeveer again in the SAE house, and as customary, his hand grip was crushing. By doing likewise, it exhausted me. Now my arms are sore and ache. Norman has been missing since Midway. At Franklin College, Norman Vandeveer had been a senior when Rocky was a freshman. At Midway, flying a dauntless SBD dive bomber, Vandeveer was one of the aviators who attacked the Japanese fleet carrier Kaga. He was awarded the Navy Cross posthumously. After bombing the Kaga, on his way home to the Enterprise, Vandeveer ditched his plane, with the last transmission reporting he was out of fuel. Rocky never talked about dreams, and this was the only time he ever wrote about one. He was fond of mathematics, not the supernatural. But that space of empty waves was a place that a ghost might haunt, or where a man's dreaming mind could turn to a friend who had gone before him to war. The war was weighing upon Rocky, and his dream marked it. As he headed for combat, he was grappling with its ghosts. At the end of the ocean, another week away, lay Australia. On October 28th, the General John S. Pope dropped anchor off Brisbane. Rocky and everyone else expected to go ashore the next day and ate breakfast early. Traveled up bay, past flat islands into a river not more 2,000 feet wide. found the town of Brisbane to be neat and colorful, built on low, regular hills. The residential district comes to a rocky-bottomed river, and for a mile, women wave to us. Women. Ah. Our boat was turned around in river, and we docked at approximately 0900. Then came the news we would not debark. Chaplain Smith was allowed ashore, no one else. He brought back 3 newspapers, 2 songbooks, a pineapple, apples, pears, bananas, and 3 pints of ice cream. The ministry of a good chaplain was practical. The Army Chaplain's Manual stressed the importance of the following qualifications: typist, musician, vocal or instrumental, experience as a printer or publicity man, sign painter, stereopticon or moving picture operator. On the voyage out, Chaplain Smith had lugged aboard his organ, hymnals, violin, and typewriter. He had played piano in the officer's lounge. He had stuck up for lower-grade NCOs when first sergeants tried to turn them out of quarters that they envied. From this point, Chaplain Smith's ministry would be summed up in lists: rosters of men for whom he arranged outings, schedules of clubs and lectures that he organized, journals and snacks that he obtained for the airmen in his charge. Rumors were rife. If the group wasn't going ashore, they must be headed even farther afield, to Sydney, to India, to Persia. But when they moved on, it was to Milne Bay, the Allied port at the eastern tip of New Guinea. They started taking Adabrin, the pill that turned skin yellow, and was said to cause impotence and represented the American answer to malaria. At least they could mail letters home now. Rocky sent 4 letters to his parents, 6 to Margaret Ann. With Lieutenant Scott, he was assigned a censor enlisted men's mail. The enlisted men seemed tense. There was a definite lack of humor in all the letters I censored, Rocky wrote. The most common comment was, "Please don't worry, I love you." "It will be a long time before I return," ran a close second. Rocky went out on deck that night with his friend Bob Folliard, another lieutenant. For the first time, they marked the energy with which the American forces moved across the New Guinea landscape. What appeared to be another jungle coastline this afternoon was a mass of lights tonight. Amphibious jeeps and trucks were in the water, and it seemed a bit strange to see automobile headlights out on the water. Searchlight batteries were in operation. These ships departing from here to the combat fields are landing barges and Liberty ships. There is a hospital ship and a large hospital, 80 nurses, here. 7-day leaves are granted after 6 months in area, perhaps on paper only. Already there were hints of how hard it was for a man to find his way back stateside. A captain who came on board to brief them had been overseas for 22 months. They transferred to a Dutch ship, the SS von Hutz, less comfortable than the John S. Pope, for her power was unreliable, her plumbing was crude, and she had been built to carry coolie labor. On November 6th, they finally went ashore. They marched for a mile through mud under palm trees to their first campsite. They kicked at land crabs, ants, and centipedes, and, Rocky and Major Smith had guessed right, washed in a river. The day after that, suddenly, they moved to Port Moresby. We woke, ate our canned rations. I ate my cereal dry so as not to dirty my mess kit. We'd clear the area of coconut logs and raked rocks so to form walks. At 1100, the chaplain, Lieutenant Unger, and I went to the small creek to wash our clothes. After washing one uniform and one pair of coveralls, I walked out to midstream and sat down. Immediately, First Sergeant Williams appeared, yelling, "All 71st men out, we are moving." The chaplain, a slow, fat southerner, bitched a little. We rushed to the area to learn we were leaving in 1 hour. At 1300, we had our equipment in trucks, climbed in, and headed off to the airport, we hoped. Along the beach, we saw 3 Jap landing barges with holes 3 feet in diameter and 1 large ship on its side. The road was narrow in places, and 1 truck got stuck. We took off at 1430. First, we went due west over a very large lake, but had to make a 180-degree turn because of a storm and reached the sea below. Along the coast were beautiful beaches, jungles one minute and grass areas another. We saw a few coconut groves and 3 native villages built on stilts. We landed at one of the seven landing strips at 1545. There were B-24s galore. We unloaded the plane. Yes, we officers did it all ourselves. Time flew. We rode and rode, over gravel roads past what looked to me huge anthills. Finally, there was a halt. Told dinner was waiting for all. And our dream came true. We had steaks. The 5th Bomber Command placed us in a native-constructed enlisted men's recreation hall and furnished miscellaneous mosquito bars, blankets, and folding cots. Sleep came in spite of the water coming through the coconut leaves. The trip had confirmed the hierarchy of rank, in which officers lived above enlisted men, relied on their labor, and read their mail. Rocky and the other airmen had seen the energy of the war, the headlights that lit the New Guinea darkness, and the bombers galore in the Port Moresby revetments. They had been mired in the mud of the tropics and been lifted out of it by American air power. They had seen the detritus of war by land and sea and been warned of the hazards of the air. The prelude to battle. Rocky had thought shipping out would be that. Even yet, the journey from Laurel to Port Moresby might not be that. But what they had seen might be summed up as an overture. 3. An island north of Australia. An island north of Australia, where Rocky had heard that the group was headed, meant New Guinea. So did the rumor that George Kenney would be the Air Corps theater commander, for New Guinea was where Kenney was fighting Douglas MacArthur's air war. New Guinea was in the Southwest Pacific. In that antipodean part of the world, there were two separate theaters of war, divided by a line as clear as the equator, as E.J. Kahn noted. The South Pacific, to clear this matter up, is an area that includes Guadalcanal. It is commanded by Admiral Halsey. The Southwest Pacific, consisting of Australia, New Guinea, and various other islands, belongs to General MacArthur. As the 71st Group unpacked barracks bags, its airmen were heading for what an experienced newspaperman called the toughest fighting in the world. The United States Army advised its soldiers, New Guinea is a primitive, hard country and a new world to men from overseas. You go there to fight a dangerous enemy, the Japanese. But they are not the only enemy. The country itself will fight you with all its forces, its mountains, swamps, and forests, its heat and rain, its snakes, crocodiles, scorpions, and lice, above all with its mosquitoes and its invisible army of disease germs. New Guinea is the second largest island on the planet. The mountains that run down its center line rank with the Rockies and the Andes as a dangerous cordillera. The main island, shaped like a rearing dragon and lying just under the equator, has a spine of mountains 1,000 miles long. At the western end, snow-capped peaks rise to more than 16,000 feet. At the eastern end, the tallest soar between 13,000 and 14,000 and are clothed almost to their summits in dense rainforests. From this mighty backbone of ranges, row upon row of razorbacks extend like herringbones, with roaring torrents in every canyon between them and everlasting rain clouds on every crest. New Guinea was a green hell, said men who served there. The Army's official history of the early fighting in New Guinea spelled out why. The Japanese could scarcely have chosen a more dismal place in which to conduct a campaign. The rainfall at many points in the peninsula is torrential. It often runs as high as 150, 200, and even 300 inches per year, and during the rainy season, daily falls of 8 or 10 inches are not uncommon. The terrain, as varied as it is difficult, is a military nightmare. Towering, sawtoothed mountains, densely covered by mountain forest and rainforest, alternate with flat malarial coastal areas. The mountains are drained by turbulent rivers and creeks, which become slow and sluggish as they reach the sea. Along the streams, the fringes of the forest become interwoven from ground to treetop level with vines and creepers to form an almost solid mat of vegetation, which has to be cut by the machete or the bolo before progress is possible. In the lowlands, rivers, swamps, and mangrove swamps dominate. Among these are broad swaths of grass, as tall as a man, kunai in pidgin or kogon grass, blady grass, Kuru Kuru, or Japanese blood grass. There are impassable rivers, the largest being the Sepik. Allied officers and infantrymen loathed the river. In its course of some 700 miles, it spread into seemingly limitless swamps, flowed deeply through a main channel a quarter of a mile or more wide in places, and bore with it masses of debris and floating islands of tangled grass and scrub. Crocodiles infested it, and hordes of mosquitoes bred there. The western half of New Guinea was Dutch, part of the Netherlands East Indies. The eastern half in 1884 had been divided by Queen Victoria and Kaiser Wilhelm I. The Germans claimed the part of the island north of the mountains, which became Kaiser Wilhelm Land, and the large islands offshore, which they renamed the Bismarck Archipelago. The British claimed the southeastern quarter of the island, which they called Papua. In 1906, the Australians assumed control of Papua. In 1914, Australian forces captured the German settlements and the German colonial capital of Rabaul. After the war, the German possessions were given to Australia as a mandate. The island of New Pomerania became New Britain, and New Mecklenburg became New Ireland. Less than half of New Guinea was under control. That meant little, only that a head tax was paid, tribal wars were no longer fought, and colonial officers administered justice. The rest of New Guinea was only under influence, or beyond that, merely penetrated by patrols. There were approximately 4,500 Europeans in the mandated territory, approximately 1,500 Europeans in Papua. The tribes native to the island numbered some 1.8 million people. The New Guinea territory continued to be governed from Rabaul, offshore on New Britain. Rabaul could boast a cross-hatching of streets beside a magnificent deep-water harbor. Its pre-war population counted 850 Europeans, 1,000 Chinese, and 4,000 Melanesians. Papua, a poorer colony, was governed from a sleepier town, Port Moresby. In 1940, Moresby had a population of 1,000 whites. Another 1,000 or so people worked in Moresby by day. They were Motuans from the villages in the area and were required to leave the white town after dusk. On the east coast, along the hundreds of miles of beaches and jungle, settlements were few. At Finchshafen, there was a German mission. At Salamaua, there was a harbor with a customs house, stores, banks, and pub. At La Haye, there was a good airfield. Amelia Earhart had taken off from there in 1938 on her last flight. The airport had been built to serve the upcountry gold mining district, and a town had grown up around it. A dozen stores, a hotel and club, 100 young white men, a few white women, 60-odd Chinese. 30 years before, the people of La Haye had welcomed the German missionaries. They themselves ran the mission school now, and they had built a church for their congregation of 700 souls. Farther north along the coast was the port of Ma Dong, which Chancellor Otto von Bismarck's empire builders had also laid out. At Ma Dong had been built a jail, hospital, quarantine station, copra warehouse, and cricket ground. There were 30 Europeans in a miniature Chinatown. The 71st Group would know Ma Dong well, the harbor, the plantations around it, and the deadly anti-aircraft guns that the Japanese put in place there. The air war in New Guinea would not be fought above the jungle. A close look at the background of most wartime aerial photos shows that the landscape is not the random, unshaped canopy of a jungle. The palm trees that form such a dense mat are usually planted in neat rows. They are the trees of hundreds of coconut plantations, white outposts along the coast. Ma Dong was surrounded by plantations. So were La Haye and Alexishafen and Finchshafen, and the coast all the way north past Hansa Bay, points connected by the old German road. The 82nd and 110th Squadrons flew missions to Arima Plantation, Yalau Plantation, Awar Plantation, Potsdam Plantation, to Ulugan Plantation too, where more than one pilot died. From the meat of the coconuts grown on these plantations, when it was dried and shipped out as copra, came the coconut oil used in soaps made by Lever Brothers and Procter & Gamble. In New Guinea, Western consumer culture had shaped the landscape where the war was fought, just as it had built the Italian pastures and vineyards where troops battled, and Normandy where armies shot at each other through the hedgerows that divided French fields. The Allied base at Milne Bay was built on a plantation, just as air bases back home were laid out on pasture land. An American pilot remembered that at Milne Bay the trees were set in a checkerboard pattern that looked like a giant cornfield. We were told that our government paid Lever Brothers $75 for every tree destroyed. In early 1942, the Japanese moved south with phenomenal speed. Within weeks after Pearl Harbor, they dispatched a fleet to deal with a solitary battalion of Australian troops that had been sent to Rabaul. On January 21st, Japanese warplanes struck the tiny white settlements of the New Guinea coast, bombing and strafing. Colonial rule collapsed, and the white population fled. Within 2 months after Pearl Harbor, while American troops were encircled on Bataan and British troops were being outfought at Singapore, only one Allied base remained above the Australian continent, Port Moresby. The Japanese had opened the war by taking control of strategic islands. In December 1941, a handful of Japanese landings cut the established air routes between the United States and Australia. Before the war, the few planes that crossed the Pacific had gone from California to Hawaii to Midway Island and Wake Island, then on via Guam to Manila or Port Moresby. After the Japanese captured Wake and Guam, American military transportation officers mapped out a new route to the Pacific theater. From Hawaii, south to Christmas Atoll, west to Canton, south to Samoa, then straight west for 3 days, via Fiji and New Caledonia to Brisbane. The route posed so many risks that the Army sent bombers to the Pacific by flying them across South America, Africa, and India, until the Japanese captured the Netherlands East Indies and cut off the northern approach to Australia. Port Moresby was fought for because it had an airfield and because its capture would perfect Japanese control of the Southwest Pacific. The Imperial Japanese Navy wanted to protect its base at Truk. That meant capturing Rabaul, the nearest established port. To protect Rabaul, in turn, it was desirable to capture Port Moresby. The Japanese fully understood the threat that land-based aircraft posed to naval forces. In Allied hands, Port Moresby could soon become a major thorn in the Japanese side. Allied heavy bombers could roam as far north as Truk. But in Japanese hands, Port Moresby could become the base for air operations against northern Australia and deep into the Coral Sea. Rabaul and Tulagi would therefore be covered in the one direction from which an enemy counterattack might materialize. Moreover, once in Japanese hands, Port Moresby would complete the air ferry route from Singapore and the Philippines via the Indies and New Guinea to Rabaul. Thus, the Japanese would have a mesh of mutually supporting air bases that could be used to concentrate overwhelming numbers of land-based aircraft against any Allied naval force. Guadalcanal, likewise, was fought for because it was airbase terrain. The Imperial Japanese Navy had never planned to fight a decisive battle at the end of a supply line stretched south into the Solomons, nor did the United States Navy plan to send its precious carriers and cruisers into those waters, so far from home and still so distant from Australia. Rather, the Japanese had landed on Guadalcanal to build a final airbase to protect Rabaul's southeastern approaches and threaten the shipping routes between Australia and the United States. From Guadalcanal, Japanese bombers could have covered the Coral Sea with an air blockade. Kawanishi flying boats could have scouted even farther afield, even as far as the safe southern course that the John S. Pope had steered. The first Japanese air raid on Port Moresby came on February 3, 1942. By the time the Japanese ceased raiding, 18 months later, Moresby had been bombed or strafed more than 100 times. Guinea Gold, the Australian military newspaper published there, was called the war's most bombed newspaper. During the early months of 1942, the situation at Port Moresby was bleak. Osmar White recalled that he and his fellow war correspondents could write of Australians defying the Japanese bombers, but they could not tell the whole truth. The story they could not tell was one of desperation and cheerless improvisation. We could not write, The strength, equipment, training, and leadership of the New Guinea force is inadequate. It is enervated by tropical diseases, and it is badly fed, overworked, discouraged, and very nearly hopeless. It is without reserves or air support. If the Japanese come, organized defense will not last more than 48 hours. At first, the Japanese air raids came daily. There were no Allied fighter planes at Moresby, and only one small battery of anti-aircraft guns. The Japanese bombers stayed high, or the Zeros strafed the town at building height, and it was weeks before the gunners actually shot down a Japanese plane. In March 1942, the Royal Australian Air Force, RAAF, flew in a squadron of P-40 fighters to defend the town. The P-40s were outclassed by the Zeros, but the pilots flew until all of their planes were shot down or wrecked. At the end of April, just when the RAAF could fight no longer, the 8th Pursuit Group of the United States Army Air Force arrived with two squadrons of P-39-era Cobras. GI engineers came ashore with them. Two black units, the first American ground troops to reach New Guinea, the 96th Engineering Battalion, colored, and the 576th Engineer Company. Veteran Australian units began to arrive, shipped home from the Middle East. The Allied situation at Port Moresby remained difficult, but no longer did it seem desperate. As well as sending air raids, the Japanese twice began campaigns to capture Port Moresby. In March 1942, a Japanese naval task force landed troops at Lae and Salamaua. American carrier planes struck the landing ships and damaged them so badly that the Japanese did not press on to land more troops at Moresby. In May, during the Battle of the Coral Sea, while the huge Japanese fleet carriers, Shokaku and Zuikaku, fought it out with the American fleet carriers, Yorktown and Lexington, Japanese losses once more saved Port Moresby. American dive bombers and torpedo planes sank the Japanese carrier Shoho, the flagship of a second Japanese invasion fleet that had hooked around the eastern tip of New Guinea, heading for the beaches at Moresby. Deprived of their air cover, the destroyers and transports of this landing force turned back to Rabaul. In July 1942, the Japanese moved southward a third time, a move that would result in two huge battles. The Japanese shipped construction troops southward along the Solomon Islands hundreds of miles to Guadalcanal. At the same time, they landed 3,500 combat troops at Buna on the east coast of New Guinea, less than 120 miles by air from Moresby. This landing force, with its engineers, bearers, and pack horses, set off for Port Moresby across the mountains. This path they chose, the Kokoda Track, would carry for Australians the same associations that other nations give to Thermopylae and Stalingrad. The Kokoda Track was a footpath that crossed numberless mountain ridges, sometimes narrowing down to a trail less than 3 feet wide. Along this rough terrain, in tropical downpours, the Japanese doggedly fought their way, encircling and overrunning Australian forces. By mid-September, the Emperor's troops were exhausted and sickened, but they were only 25 miles from Port Moresby, so close that they could see the ocean beyond the port. Here they were supposed to hold, while reinforcements arrived. At this point, the forward troops were recalled, ordered to fall back on the coast. A second Japanese landing in New Guinea, at Milne Bay, had failed. At Guadalcanal, the fighting had intensified. The Japanese Imperial Army staff had committed to that island the infantrymen and warplanes meant to support the Kokoda expedition. When the Japanese fell back from the Kokoda track, they dug in at Buna, where they had come ashore. They fought from bunkers made from thick coconut logs overgrown with grass or jungle vines. The Japanese had fortified the high ground, which meant, in the marshy terrain at Buna, that the Japanese held all the terrain that was not actually covered with muck or standing water. The Australian 9th Division came down in pursuit from the mountains, and a fresh American unit, the 32nd Division, was brought into action, ferried by air from northern Australia to Port Moresby. The Americans opened a new front on the east coast of New Guinea. Some of the new American regiments followed a tortuous trail across the mountains, but other Allied troops in a striking advance were flown directly to the combat zone. Engineers found a landing field site near Buna at Wanigela Mission, and an advance guard hacked out in the kunai grass a strip on which transport planes could land. Kenney then rushed in a battalion of Australian infantry to defend the place, and 100 American engineers to build a longer airstrip, and began flying in soldiers and munitions. At Buna, a squadron of Zeros was flying from a pre-war grass airfield at the old mission. 5th Air Force warplanes caught the Zeros on the ground, strafed them, and cratered the runway. With air superiority gained, the Allies were able not only to fly in supplies by air, but to send munitions northward along the coast. The 5th Air Force took on a decisive role. Its transports moved whole regiments.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.